Welcome to the session 4. Electro-pneumatic control system. Here, in the method 1, the switch S when activated manually energizes the coil C, which makes the cylinder to extend. When the switch is released, it breaks the contact, de-energized the coil C. The valve returns to its normal position due to spring. High pressure air flows to the rod end side and retracts the cylinder. That is that you can observe from the figure 1. That is when the switch S actuates manually, the coil gets energized, the coil C gets energized, that is solenoid, which makes the cylinders to extend. When the switch is released, it breaks the contact, de-energizes the coil C. Then the valve returns to its normal position due to spring. So high pressure air flows to the rod end side of the cylinder and retracts the cylinder. When it comes to method 2, you can observe from the figure 2. In this case, a relay is made use to carry the signal to the solenoid C. The remaining action as in the case of method 1. You can observe from the figure 2. In case of the third case, the cylinder has to return in the extended position even though the switch is released. Then the circuit diagram, you can observe the second one that can be used. If the cylinder has to retract after the extension, then the switch S can be replaced by a limit switch LS located at the end of the extended stroke. Similarly, for continuous reciprocation of the piston, that is continuous extension and retraction, two limit switches LS and LS. And LS can be located at the end of the extension and retraction stroke. Electro-pneumatic control. In this, there is a control of single acting spring return cylinder that I would like to talk about here. The figure the figure shows the control circuitry for single acting cylinder. That is actuation of electro-pneumatic circuitry to control the actuation of single acting cylinder utilizes 3x2 solenoid actuated spring return DC valve. The solenoid is energized by means of a momentary manual switch S. As the switch S is released, the spring of the valve returns the valve to its normal position, which in turn retracts the cylinder. That is, extension and retraction of the cylinder can be done by operating the switch S. Figure shows the circuit diagram of electro-pneumatic control of a double acting cylinder. Earlier, that is the control circuitry for single acting cylinder here, you can observe. Then here it is a double acting cylinder. In the double acting cylinder, the electro-pneumatic control of a double acting cylinder uses 4x2 solenoid actuated spring return cylinder valve. However, the solenoid is energized using momentary manual switch S, and which actuates the valve and hence extends the cylinder. As the switch is released, the solenoid so it gets de-energized, the valve returns to its original position, thereby retracting the cylinder. Generally, the main source of supply will be alternating current whose voltage is reduced, rectified into DC supply, which is input to solenoid. So, next chapter in this is compressed air. In the compressed air, some of the highlights of the compressed air here are production of compressed air, or compressors, preparation of compressed air, air dryers, air filters, air regulators, lubricants, distribution of compressed air, piping layout. When it comes to introductory part of compressed air here, compressed air is a vast majority of pneumatic systems utilize the compressed air as the operating medium, while very small number of uses nitrogen as the operating medium. As you know, the main difference between the fluid system, that is hydraulic system, and the pneumatic system. The pneumatic system utilizes the compressed air for its as a working media, and even in the fresh air also from the atmosphere. When it comes to fluid system, hydraulic fluid or hydraulic system, it utilizes the oil is the working media. In the same way here, in the compressed air, and almost all the pneumatic circuitry system or pneumatic system utilizes the compressed air as the working media. If that is the case, how to generate the compressed air? The air drawn from the atmosphere and its pressure is raised using an air compressor. And also we could observe from the circuit diagram of structure of a pneumatic control system, that is, the air from the atmosphere is drawn and it passes through the air filters where it can be remove the contaminants, and it passes to the compressors where it gets the air gets compressed from lower pressures to higher pressures. The compressors can be classified based on the choice of compressors available. So quantity of air required, pressure of air required, quantity and the container, cleanliness of air, levels of dryness of air. There are varying levels of these criteria which depends on the type of compressors. The compressors are mainly classified into two types. One is positive displacement compressors and non-positive compressors. These are also called as dynamic compressors, which are similar to that of the pumps, in the fluid power system. And here, the positive displacement compressors are further classified into two types, that is reciprocating air compressor, piston compressor, and rotary compressors. And this reciprocating compressors are classified into two types. One is a piston compressor, the other one is diaphragm compressors. Whereas in the flow compressors are further classified into two types, that is, non-positive displacement is also called as dynamic compressor, which is nothing but a flow compressor. It has two types, that is radial flow compressors and axial flow compressors. When it comes to rotary compressors or positive displacement compressors are of three types. One is sliding vane compressor, the other one is twin shaft screw compressor, the third one is root compressor. The positive, as I mentioned earlier, the positive displacement compressors are of two types. One is piston compressor, the other one is rotary compressors. Piston compressors are those which consist of reciprocating piston operating in a cylinder driven by a prime mover. As the figure observed from the figure, that is, air is drawn from the atmosphere at atmospheric pressure during the suction stroke and extending stroke through the inlet valve, and compresses the same during working or retracting stroke, and delivers higher pressure air through the outlet valve. Either during extension or retraction, the air gets compressed from a lower pressures to an higher pressure. The other figure, it shows the working principle of piston compressor. The piston compressors, the basic working principle of piston compressor here. The piston compressors are of two types, that is single stage compressor and two stage and multi-stage compressor. Piston compressors are of two types, again single acting compressor and double acting compressor. So you can observe from the figure that a single acting compressor, how it works. There is an inlet valve, outlet valve, and piston rod, cylinder, crank, and connecting rod. There are pins outside the cylinder. Okay, the higher pressure, the air from the atmosphere enter into the cylinder when it extends. And then it gets converted into a higher pressure air in the at the end of the stroke, that is retraction. That is piston compressors are by most of the common type of air compressors are single acting compressors, you can observe. The construction part, when it comes, it consists of a cylinder with a crank connected to a crankshaft. Crank is connected to the piston rod. The cylinder is provided with fins on its outer surface for dissipation of heat generating during compression of the air. The compressor is said to be air cooled because heat from the fins to reservoir will be dissipated to the atmosphere. Single acting compressor, air compressor. When it comes to working principle, as the piston moves away from the compressor head, the inlet valve opens, that is when it moves from cap end to rod end, the inlet valve gets opened and it draws the air from the atmosphere through the filter. This stroke is called suction stroke. That is, stroke is nothing but a movement of the piston from cap end to rod end and then rod end to cap end. As the piston moves during the return stroke, the inlet valve gets closed and the air in the cylinder gets compressed to compressed and increased to a higher temperature, that you can observe from the figure. The exhaust valve opens when the compressed air reaches to a specified temperature. Specified pressure. This stroke is piston is called this stroke of piston is called a compression stroke and exhaust stroke. The valve are spring loaded with which opens and close the action of air pressure across them. Since the contact of air is on only one side of the piston with a single cylinder is called single acting cylinder. That means the only during the extension it takes the air from the atmosphere and air pressure pushes the piston from the cap end to rod end and that is extending of the cylinder and extension stroke started. And for the retraction stroke, the force for the pressure for the retraction stroke gravity or loaded gravity loaded or spring loaded. Hence the name called single acting cylinder. That is, air acts only on one side. Hence the name called single acting cylinder. When it comes to double acting cylinder, that is both extension and retraction is due to the highly pressurized air. A single acting compressor produces pressure pulse at each of its stroke or working stroke. A more even air supply can be obtained using double acting cylinder air compressor. Figure shows double acting cylinder. The name double acting cylinder because the extension and retraction of the cylinder taking place through the pressurized air. That is, during the extension stroke, the air from the atmosphere enter into the inlet valve and it acts on the piston head, which pushes the piston towards the rod end side. So, for the retraction stroke, when the piston starts moving from rod end to cap end, due to the pressurized air acts on the other side of the valve enter into the cylinder. Again, it acts on the piston head, which pushes the piston head along with the rod towards rod end cap end side. So retraction will be taking place. In a double acting cylinder, compressor suction and compression of air takes place on both sides of the piston, is the name called double acting, as I mentioned earlier. So here, two stage air compressors. Compression of air will be taking place in two stages. In the stage one, what will happen here? The pressure attained by air in a single cylinder may not be to the required level, and to obtain the desired pressure level of air. So, hence the two stages are used called multi-stage. Figure shows the working principle of a two-stage compressor. This contains two cylinders driven by a common motor. So, you can observe there is a common motor, there is a cylinder 1 and the cylinder 2, the stage 1 and stage 2. As the air drawn from the atmosphere at the atmospheric pressure during the suction stroke of the piston through the inlet valve V1, and the compressed air is delivered through the outlet valve V2, you can observe. So there is a valve V1 and V2. So two cylinders along with the piston and rod is been driven by a common motor. The compression of air taking place in two stages. This compressed air at pressure P drawn into the second cylinder and compressed air pressure P2 for further. In between the cylinders, there is the hot air is cooled before it enters the second cylinder, because the pressure increases, temperature of the air gets also increases. So it may damage the intricate parts of the second cylinder. So therefore, it should be cooled before entering into the second cylinder. The working principle in this system adopted with a more number of stages to achieve very high pressures, and such a system is called multi-stage air compressor. Diaphragm compressor, this is another type of compressor. It is used to reduce the friction between the piston and the inner surface of the cylinder and other moving parts. In lubricating oil is used, because you know when the piston moves in the cylinder, that is cap end to rod end and rod end to cap end, pressure of the air gets increased. Due to, as the pressure increases, temperature also increases, thereby when it moves from cap end to rod end, rod end to cap end, the friction between the piston and along with the intricate parts of the cylinder gets increases. So it has to be removed by the frictional forces has to be reduced, because it affects greatly on the efficiency of the device. So to avoid that, we have to lubricate it. Since the air is in direct contact with the piston during suction and compression stroke, there is a possibility that air may get mixed with a small amount of oil. So here what will happen, there is an undesirable effects will be taking place in case of food and chemical industries. So to achieve totally clean air diaphragm, pressure compressors are used. So the diaphragm compressors are also a piston compressor, but with a flexible diaphragm between the piston and the air is used, which avoids the undesirable effects when the air gets contact with the oil, that is pressurized air gets contact with the oil. So figure shows the diaphragm compressor of a totally clean compressed air. Yeah, so one. To reduce the friction between the piston and the inner surface of the cylinder and the other moving parts, lubricating oil is needed. So here in the diaphragm compressor for a totally clean air, piston compressors are used even high pressures, say about 20 bars and above, relatively a smaller volume of the 10,000 meters per hour. Or less air is needed. In addition to this, they have a relatively complex mechanism with more number of moving parts. Next is rotary compressors. Rotary compressors consist of compressing elements mounted shafts, rotate and draw air through the inlet. The air is compressed between the intermesh elements and the pressure air is left out due to the receiver through the outlet port via an air gear. Rotary compressors are used when medium pressure less than 10 bars and medium flow, say about 10,000 per meter square per hour is needed. Many applications requires only medium pressure pressure flow. Rotary compressors have certain disadvantages. The different types of rotary compressors are, some of the disadvantages here is fewer moving parts rotating at constant speed, and apart from all this, delivers steady air without pressure pulse. Types of rotary compressors, that is dry screw rotary compressor, vane compressor, liquid ring compressors. Screw compressors, you can observe, that is intermeshing of screws here and drive shaft, outlet and inlet. Screw compressor consists of an intermeshing screws with a minimal clearance of around 0.05 millimeter. The two screws are housed in a chamber provided with an outlet valve. The screws can be independently driven, or one intermeshing screws can be the driver and the outlet, other may be driven. That is, two screws are used, one is driven, the other one is driver. The construction of a screw compressor can be observed from the figure. That is, when it moves from one position to the other position, that is, you know what will happen, the inlet ports gets opened, and the that is instead of piston we are using screws here, otherwise the working procedure is same. As the air as the screws rotate, creates partial vacuum and draws air mixed with a small amount of oil to reduce the friction between the rotating screws, since the distance between the screws, you know, it will be very small, 0.05 millimeter, which causes, you know, there may be a rubbing action between the screws which causes frictional forces. So to avoid that, air has to be mixed with a small quantity of oil. The air drawn is compressed between the screws and delivered at the outlet valve in a constant pulse free system. If no oil is used along with the air, there is the, when both the screws are driven independently, then it is called dry screw compressors. Otherwise it is called wet screw compressors. So in these compressors, screw compressors, there are two types. One is dry screw compressor, the other one is wet screw compressors. In the dry screw compressors, the screws are driven independently, and whereas in wet screw compressors, small amount of oil is used. Wet screw compressors introduces a oil contamination into the compressed air, which is to be removed later by oil separator